We need to take the voices of our children seriously. They're telling us already the most crucial issues in their lives. They're sharing with us already the most poignant and meaningful questions they have. We need to listen and be willing to have a discussion that's uncomfortable or unfamiliar, or for which we might be unprepared, because they're asking.
America's young people are in crisis. The rising rates of mental and emotional problems among our children and adolescents alert us to the emergency.
By every measure, there are more youngsters suffering from depression, anxiety, diagnosable emotional illness, in juvenile lockups, having trouble flourishing, experiencing failure academically. By all of these measures, there are increasing numbers of youngsters in need of support from all of us.
This crisis is not the fault of our children, but of our community. A lack of connectedness, close connections to other people, and deep connections to moral and spiritual meaning is at the root of the crisis.
We're not giving children two kinds of connectedness. One, enduring connections with others who care about them and care about the kind of person they're going to be when they grow up. And we're not giving them a sense of meaning and connectedness to moral and spiritual meaning. To solve the problem, we have to think much more structurally and socially about the health of our overall civil society.
The best solution for this crisis is to flood young people with relationships in their family, relationships in their community, and opportunities to develop their moral and their spiritual growth. Because the research demonstrates when kids have those connections with their families, with their communities, and with guidance for moral and spiritual truth, they tend to do better in life, however you want to measure.
Our society can best respond to the crisis by building and strengthening authoritative communities. This new public policy and social science term describes groups that live out the types of connectedness our children lack.
An authoritative community is a community in which the institutions, the people in them, support the development of children. They provide role models, people with whom the children can identify with, imitate, internalize their attitudes, their values, their ways of managing the world. They're caring people, they are supportive people, they're important role models, and they take responsibility for helping children grow in a responsible way.
Recent scientific findings reviewed in the report prove that we are all hardwired to connect, born with a need and a desire to seek close attachments to others. This process begins with mothers and fathers and eventually extends to other family members and a broader community.
Hardwired to connect means that human beings weren't just plunked on the earth to kind of, you know, go on autopilot. It means that the way we are created, our systems just hunger for relationship for other people.
We may also be hardwired for meaning, born with a built-in drive to seek and to find purpose in life.
Our brains are hardwired to seek meaning because we cannot help but answer questions. We are inherently a curious species, and part of our brains were kind of developed in that way to create questions and to seek those answers.
Meeting children's deep need for connections to other people and to meaning is essential to their health and development. It is also the primary task of authoritative communities.
So an authoritative community is any group. It could be a father-daughter, you know, pancake group at the church. It could be a boys or girls club. It could be a mommy and me play group. Or it could be a big, you know, youth-serving organization in society. Or it could be a neighborhood sports team. It's any group that involves children and that models for them the kind of connectedness that they increasingly are lacking.
But can nurturing social connections really determine children's behavior? Or is heredity more important?
Basically, the nature-nurture debate is moot. We still need to understand the relationship between our makeup, our biological makeup, and behavior. But we do understand already that it's an interactive process, that it is both nature and nurture.
We've reached a synthesis. They both matter and they work together.
Science has also produced important insights into adolescent brain development. Alterations in brain structure and function may account for some of the distinctive behavioral changes that accompany adolescence.
What happens with teenagers is that it takes more to stimulate them, and the desire for novelty, the desire for risk-taking, and the desire for bonding with one's peers goes way up. Other things like some kinds of judgment are not as developed, actually get worse. So the trick for society is to meet those needs in ways that aren't going to hurt these kids but are going to help them.
We also know now that boys and girls differ with respect to risk factors for social pathology. Not attending to differences between them can have dangerous consequences.
You know, to take the most obvious case, you know, young women in their sexual development are at risk for early sexual activity, early pregnancy, you know, sexual diseases, and should one become pregnant at, you know, educational failure and dropout. Young boys with that surge of, you know, physical energy and aggressive drives often are much more at risk for being involved in both injury to themselves and injuries to others, or to be involved in the, you know, juvenile justice system because they get into trouble. So we need to address that there are some differences in risk.
Our sense of right and wrong originates from our hardwired need to connect with others. Morality begins with attachment, and like charity, attachment begins at home. Families are a key authoritative institution. To strengthen them, we need to become a society in which more and more children are growing up with their own two married parents.
Morality begins with a baby. The most spiritual thing on earth is a human infant because its interests are strictly personal. And it is through the love of parents and their offspring that all morality has its origin.
Living a good life also involves a significant spiritual component. Religious practice can lead to happiness, hope, and a sense that life has meaning and purpose.
I think where we want to go as a society is to strengthen authoritative communities so that there is more for youngsters to hang on to as they develop, which gives them a sense of the dignity of every person and the meaningfulness not only of material things, but also of transcendent values.
All of us, youth service professionals, parents, educators, religious and civic leaders, employers, and individual citizens must act now on behalf of America's young people.
One way that we can start to get out of this crisis is to see it as incumbent upon us as youth service professionals to take up the mantle of spiritual and moral growth. Adolescents and older children are looking for direction. They want to know what's good and evil, and they want to be their better selves. They're looking to us as youth leaders to help show them how in a daily way they can be their best person.
A lot of us as adults, we know what we should be doing. As parents, we should be devoting time with our children in a way that certainly cherishes them, yet also doesn't, you know, take it out of context and place too much importance on the child. There need to be those limits and expectations. But as community members, there are places that we can go to volunteer to help out. There are places we can give our charitable dollars to strengthen. But it's also as simple as knowing the name of your paper boy, seeing the same kid bagging your groceries and asking how things are going at school. Very simple, everyday things that affirm the specialness of that child. Just taking an extra moment to recognize that young person and make a difference in their life.
In a way, we're all in the same boat together and need the same focus. On the other hand, the poor and certain minority communities, there are certain skills and opportunities that you really have to concentrate on providing that are not readily available to to a group of people who've been closed out of mainstream opportunities, because many of the policymakers and practitioners in this country do not come from poor and minority communities, and very often assume that they are where they are because of their intellectual gifts, and do not know that it's their connections, that it is their social skills, their personal development and control, many things that they take for granted that low-income people do not receive simply because they don't grow up with parents who know how to function within certain mainstream environments and opportunity structures. My mother was a domestic worker, and my father was a steel mill laborer. Many of the mainstream skills, one, came from our church involvement, but also as a domestic worker, my mother observed mainstream habits, skills, attitudes, ways of managing the world, ways of making things happen that got transmitted back to us at home.
To end the crisis among America's youth, we must work for and win support for a major shift in public policy and awareness to empower authoritative communities.
I think the number one public policy influence that is needed when we think about authoritative communities is to remember that this work is done best by non-professionals, by everyday Americans in everyday communities. And public policy needs to do all it can with laws, with funding, with opportunities to make a difference in the lives of kids.
You know, the main thing I feel like saying to people that are working with kids today is that how important the work is, how the work you're doing with children today is not only affecting that particular child or group of children, but is really affecting their children.
And many people can tell you about that teacher who made a difference for them. It's that presence of caring, supportive people that children need, and you don't know when it's going to make a huge difference, and you don't know who will make a huge difference.
There are the unsung heroes working every day in the lives of kids, you know, starting with parents overcoming huge odds to raise great kids. There are those grassroots community organizations out there, teachers and faith-based organizations and others who are doing wonderful work with kids. So we shouldn't just sit in our living rooms and read the newspaper and lament the problems. We need to go out, we need to find those opportunities where we can plug in and make a difference in the lives of kids.
If you'd like to help increase the number of American children whose lives are touched by authoritative communities, here are three ways you can help. First, take a personal inventory. Are you now an active member of one or more authoritative communities? If not, consider joining one. You can learn more about authoritative communities and how they work by obtaining the Hardwired to Connect report from the Institute for American Values. Second, act locally. Get involved with community groups in your own neighborhood. Third, act nationally. Become a change agent in our larger society. Across the board, from the private sector to public policy, we need to invest more time and money in strengthening authoritative communities. The Hardwired to Connect report shows some of the specific steps that you can take to work for this kind of social change.